Hello students, my name is Ruchika. I welcome you to the English Academy, CBSE Class 12th, Flamingo Chapter 5, Indigo by Louis Fisher. I'll tell you about the poet, background of the chapter, explanation and summary. Louis Fisher was the son of a fish peddler. He was born in Philadelphia on 29th February 1896. Initially, he was a school teacher, but he quit this job to work as a journalist in New York City with the New York Evening Post. And the following year, he moved to Moscow and began working for The Nation. Background of Indigo. The lesson is an excerpt from Fisher's book, The Life of Mahatma Gandhi. After his return to India in the year 1915, Mahatma Gandhi set about organizing peasants, farmers and urban laborers to protest against excessive land tax and discrimination. He tells the author the reasons that led him to ask the British to leave India, hence initiating the freedom struggle. The lesson gives a detailed account of his struggle for the poor peasants of Champaran. Now here you can see where Champaran is exactly located. It is in Bihar to the northwest. You can see Paschim Champaran and Purbi Champaran districts. Explanation of Indigo. It was in the year December 1916 at the annual convention of the Indian National Congress Party in Lucknow. Here, a peasant from Champaran by the name of Rajkumar Shukla met Mahatma Gandhi and he requested him to accompany him to his district Champaran in Bihar. Further, Mahatma Gandhi tells the author that these peasants worked as sharecroppers. Sharecroppers work under a system which is called sharecropping, in which a landowner allows a tenant to use the land in return for a share of the crops produced on their portion of land. So these peasants basically worked as tenants on huge land which was owned by rich landlords. Further, he says that this peasant, Rajkumar Shukla, was illiterate, but he was determined to complain against the injustice of the landlord system in Bihar. Here the word resolute has been used, which means determined. His determination is indicated by the fact that as Mahatma Gandhi was busy with prior appointments, Shukla waited for him. He accompanied him everywhere from Kanpur to his ashram for weeks. He stayed with him, asking him to fix a date. Mahatma Gandhi says he begged him to fix a date. That means he wanted him to give an appointment to visit Champaran. Now Mahatma Gandhi was very impressed by his determination. Tenacity here means perseverance and determination. So he told Rajkumar Shukla that he was about to go to Calcutta in the near future. So from there he would accompany him to Champaran. So on the date that had been fixed by Mahatma Gandhi, Shukla waited eagerly for him and from there they took a train to Patna. In Patna, Shukla took Gandhiji to the house of Rajendra Prasad. He is the same person who went on to become the first president of Free India. He was a prominent lawyer in Bihar. As Rajendra Prasad was not at home, they left and they went on to their way to Champaran. On the way, Gandhiji decided to first visit Muzaffarpur. In those days, the Indians were afraid of the Britishers and so they did not provide shelter to those who were involved in the freedom struggle. So Gandhiji sent a telegram to Professor J.B. Kriplani in Muzaffarpur and he stayed with a teacher of a government school over there for 2 days. As the news of Gandhiji's advent spread to other places, so peasants from Muzaffarpur and Champaran began arriving there on foot and by conveyance to see their champion. Now champion here indicates that this person was fighting for their rights. So they thought him to be a champion for them. He would be fighting for their cause. In Muzaffarpur, many prominent lawyers of Bihar came and met Gandhiji in order to apprise him of the situation. They frequently represented the peasants in the courts also. Gandhiji asked them about their fee and they accepted this fact that they charged the peasants a huge amount as fee. So Gandhiji was very angry at this and he scolded the lawyers for collecting such huge amounts as fee from these poor sharecroppers. Finally, he concluded that the peasants would not go to courts in the future. He said that going to the court is not much help to the peasants. He felt that the peasants are so crushed and fear-stricken, law courts are useless. The real relief for them is to be free from fear. So what he concluded was that going to the courts is useless for the peasants afraid of the Britishers. So for them the real relief is to be free from fear of the Britishers and the landowners. Then the author tells us that the arable or the cultivated land in the district of Champaran was divided into large estates and these estates were mainly owned by Britishers, Englishmen. And the Indian peasants worked there as tenants. They forced these peasants to grow indigo, which was a commercial crop and was very profitable for them. As per the sharecropping agreement between these landowners and these peasants, they would plant 15% of their land with indigo and they would surrender the entire harvest as rent. Now, synthetic indigo had been produced in Germany, no longer needed the indigo that was produced in India. So they wanted to end this sharecropping arrangement and they asked the tenants to pay compensation for that. So as this arrangement of sharecropping was very irritable for the peasants, some of them agreed to it, while some of them who resisted were forced to agree by power and by threat. So what happened after some time? The peasants came to know that synthetic indigo was being produced in Germany and that was the reason why their sharecropping agreement had been nullified. So they did not want to pay compensation to the landowners and hence they wanted their money back. Now when Gandhiji arrived in Champaran, he first visited the secretary of the British Landlords Association. The secretary refused to give him any information, saying that he was an outsider. But Gandhiji refused accepting this and he said that he was not an outsider. After that, Gandhiji visited the British official commissioner of the Tirhut division. Now, Tirhut division is the bigger place under which Champaran district lay. So then Gandhiji says that the commissioner also bullied him and advised him to leave Tirhut. But Gandhiji did not leave. He proceeded to Motihari. Motihari is the capital of Champaran. Over there, many lawyers accompanied Gandhiji. At the railway station, there were many people to welcome him. He went to a house and he used it as his headquarters and continued to investigate into the matter. He came to know that a peasant had been maltreated in a nearby village and he went to visit him. But on the way, he was stopped by a messenger of the superintendent of the police. Gandhiji went with the messenger back to his home and there the messenger served him a notice to leave Champaran. He accepted the notice and wrote below it that he would disobey the order. Subsequently, he was called upon in the court to appear. As he was called in the court the next day, he remained awake the entire night. He sent a telegraph to Rajendra Prasad to come over to Motihari with some of his influential friends. He also instructed the ashram that in case he would be arrested, then what they were supposed to do. And he also reported the entire incident to the viceroy. Now, viceroy is a term which is derived from the Latin prefix vice, which means in the place of, and the French word that is roi, which means king. So viceroy means an official who runs a country, colony or city province in the name of and as representative of the monarch. The next day in the morning, the place was full of peasants who were unaware of who Gandhiji was, and they did not know his accomplishments in South Africa. Here the author says, morning found the town of Motihari black with peasants. Now there were so many people that you could see their heads, and so he says Motihari was black with peasants. These people had merely heard that there was a Mahatma who wanted to help them. He was in trouble with the authorities, and so they had come to show their support for him. Now Gandhiji says that their spontaneous demonstration around the courthouse was the beginning of their liberation from fear. This indicated that these poor peasants had gathered courage to stand against the British oppression. Now the officials felt powerless without Gandhiji's cooperation. Gandhiji helped them to regulate the crowd. He gave the Britishers concrete proof that their might, that their strength, which was earlier dreaded and unquestioned. So, earlier the people were scared of their might, were scared of the Britishers, and they would not question them. But now it could be challenged by the Indians. Now the Indians were becoming fearless and they were challenging the Britishers. And as the government was baffled, the procedure of the court was taking a lot of time. The judge also postponed the trial. So Gandhiji, he revolted against the delay. He said in the court that he was caught in a conflict of duties. Now, conflict of duties means that on the one hand, he did not want to set a bad example as a lawbreaker, and on the other hand, he wanted to give humanitarian and national service to the people. So he says that he did not want to disregard the law, he did not want to be termed as a lawbreaker, and so he was not taking any action against the authorities. He came to the court also when he was summoned. He did not want the people to have a bad example from him, that he wants to render humanitarian and national service. He is working for the cause of the people. That is why he will not obey the court orders. He disregarded the order to leave, not for want of respect for lawful authority, but in obedience to the higher law of our being, the voice of conscience. So he says that as the order had been given to him to leave Champaran and go, he did not obey this order. His conscience was telling him that he should stay there and he should fight for the cause of the poor peasants. Then the author tells us that he would pronounce sentence after a 2-hour break, and he wanted Gandhiji to furnish a bail for those 2 hours. He refused to furnish any bail, and as he was right, the judge allowed him to be free without bail. After the 2-hour break, the court again sat. The judge said that he would not deliver the judgment for several days, and he allowed Gandhiji to remain at liberty. After that, many prominent lawyers who had come from Bihar, they met Gandhiji. And they thought that what would they do if he was sentenced to prison. All these lawyers also thought that Gandhiji was a pivotal man for them, and they wanted him to be there as their support. So they were baffled that if he would be arrested, what would they do? So finally, they all decided to court arrest. They accordingly went back to Gandhiji and told him they were ready to follow him into jail. Here, Gandhiji says, the battle of Champaran is won. Why does he say this? Because when so many prominent lawyers are supporting him, obviously the Britishers will not arrest all of them, and they have to give in to the demands of these people. After many days, the lieutenant governor of the province gave a communication to Gandhiji that the case had been dropped. Gandhiji says that this incident marked the victory of civil disobedience for the first time in modern India. Now, what is civil disobedience? It is the refusal to obey certain laws, demands, and commands of a government or of an occupying international power. It is symbolic or ritualistic violation of the law rather than a rejection of the system as a whole. It is sometimes defined as being non-violent resistance. Now, after being free, Gandhiji and his group of lawyers proceeded to conduct an in-depth inquiry into the grievances of the farmers. They took depositions from about 10,000 peasants and it collected other evidence also. The documents were also collected. Then Gandhiji was summoned by the Lieutenant Governor. He made plans. In case he did not return, then civil disobedience should be put into practice. Now, the Lieutenant Governor appointed an official commission of inquiry into the situation. The commission consisted of landlords, government officials, and Gandhiji was the sole representative of the peasants. Now, here Gandhiji says that the visit, which he thought would take a few days, occupied almost a year of his life. And it was on the initiation of an unlettered peasant, that means an illiterate, uneducated, poor farmer. Now, the official inquiry which was set, it assembled a lot of evidence against the big planters. It said that the planters were guilty. And when the planters saw this evidence, they agreed that they were wrong and they agreed to refund the money to the peasants. Now, as huge amount of supporting information was gathered by Gandhiji and his supporters, the planters were crushed by its impact and they had to refund the money to the peasants. Now, they had thought that Gandhiji would ask for 100% of the repayment and they would refuse. But Gandhiji only asked for 50% of the amount. The landlords offered to pay them only 25% of the amount that they had paid, but Gandhiji accepted the amount. Gandhiji observed that the amount of compensation is not that important. As much as important the fact that these landowners have refunded the money to the peasants, and with that they have also parted away with their prestige. Prestige means your self-respect. After a few years, the British planters abandoned their estates and they reverted back to the peasants. The indigo sharecropping system had disappeared. Gandhiji never contented himself with large political or economic solutions. He saw the cultural and social backwardness in the Champaran villages and wanted to do something about it immediately. This episode that happened in Champaran was a turning point in Gandhiji's life. He says that what he did was very ordinary. He told the outsiders, the Britishers, that they could not order him in his own country. Then he says that Champaran did not begin as an act of defiance. Act of defiance is a group action in opposition to those in power. He says it grew out of an attempt to alleviate the distress of large numbers of poor peasants. He says that his only attempt was to help the poor peasants who were in distress. This was the typical pattern of Gandhiji's politics. His politics was mixed with the practical day-to-day problems of the people. Then the author says his was not a loyalty to abstractions. It was a loyalty to living human beings. Loyalty to abstractions means being idealistic, that is working towards achieving a particular set of ideals. Gandhiji was not loyal towards reaching an ideal solution in an ideal world, but instead he was loyal to the problems faced by the real people. He focused on the particular problems that these peasants faced. Then, as they had begun the Champaran action, there was an Englishman by the name of Charles Freer Andrews. He was also a pacifist. Pacifist is a person who believes in non-violence. Now, he wanted to support these Indians. Gandhiji told his supporters that you should not seek a prop in Mr. Andrews because he happens to be an Englishman. Now, Gandhiji told his supporters, that is the lawyers and Rajendra Prasad specifically, who remembers this, that Gandhiji told them to be self-reliant, that is to rely on their own powers and resources rather than those of others. So this is how Rajendra Prasad tells us that Gandhiji taught them self-reliance and Indian independence and the help to the sharecroppers all happened together. Summary of indigo. The author tells us Gandhiji's account of the beginning of his freedom struggle from Champaran. During the annual convention of the Indian National Congress Party in Lucknow in December 1916, a poor farmer from Champaran, Rajkumar Shukla, met him. He asked Gandhiji to help him and his fellow peasants. His determination forced Gandhiji to accompany him. The peasants of Champaran worked as tenants on huge farms in return for a share of the crops. Shukla took Gandhi to the house of Rajendra Prasad, who at that time was a prominent lawyer in Bihar. As he was out of town, Gandhi proceeded to Champaran and stopped at Muzaffarpur, where he stayed at the house of Professor Malkani, a teacher. Due to a fear of the British, the Indians did not help those involved in the freedom struggle. The news of the arrival of Gandhi spread from Muzaffarpur to Champaran, and peasants gathered there to have a look at Gandhi. The lawyers met him and gave him a detailed account of the matter. The lawyers accepted that they charged high fee from the peasants, for which Gandhiji scolded them. He decided that the peasants would stop going to the courts and that the real relief for them was the freedom from fear. The peasants in Champaran worked as tenants on huge farms owned by Englishmen and were forced to cultivate indigo and gave 15% of the entire crop as rent. As synthetic indigo had been produced by Germany, the owners released the tenants from the earlier contract but charged them compensation for their release. When the peasants came to know of the synthetic indigo from Germany, they wanted their money back. Gandhiji tried to gather information from the secretary of the British Landlords Association, British official commissioner of the Tirhut division, but was denied and asked to leave. He went to Motihari, the capital of Champaran, to investigate into the matter. He was on his way to a nearby village where a peasant had been maltreated, but was intercepted by the police superintendent's messenger, who asked him to return and gave him a notice to leave Champaran. Gandhiji disobeyed the notice, following which he was summoned by the court. He was awake through the night, telegraphed Rajendra Prasad to come with his influential friends, instructed the ashram in case he did not return, and wired a detailed report to the viceroy. The town was full of peasants who supported Gandhiji, and the officials were unable to handle them without the support of Gandhiji and were threatened by the Indians, who were now challenging their once unquestioned and dreaded might. Gandhiji protested against the delay in trial, confessed of being guilty, trapped in a conflicting situation, on one hand not to be a lawbreaker and on the other to support the poor peasants. He disregarded the order on moral grounds and was ready to pay the penalty. For a break of 2 hours, Gandhiji was asked to furnish bail. He refused and was released without it also. The judge postponed the judgment for a few days and freed Gandhiji. The lawyers from Bihar decided to court arrest in case Gandhiji was arrested. The lieutenant governor of the province ordered the case to be dropped, and so civil disobedience won. Gandhiji and the lawyers conducted a detailed inquiry and had 4 meetings with the lieutenant governor. An in-depth inquiry gathered a lot of evidence against the rich planters. They agreed to refund the money to the peasants. Gandhiji accepted a 25% refund, as he thought that the amount was not as important as the fact that they had surrendered money and with it their supremacy also. This encouraged the peasants and made them free from the fear of the landowners, who behaved like lords. After a few years, landlords vanished and the landholdings reverted back to the peasants. Gandhiji did not limit the issues up to political and economic matters, but also looked into the cultural and social backwardness of Champaran. This was the turning point in Gandhiji's life, as he made it clear to the British that they could not order the Indians in their own country. Gandhiji's politics was not aimed at the achievement of a set of ideas, but it was aimed at the problems which are faced by the millions of Indians. Rajendra Prasad recollects that Gandhiji refused help from Charles Freer Andrews, an English pacifist, as he wanted them to be strong and depend upon themselves. Thank you, and for more English lessons, subscribe to English Academy.